So the whole world will know that we're not alone. It's waiting for you. Knocking at your door. Every moment of truth when your heart hits the floor. And I'll be my brother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone.
Sweet love, and what Rob needs now is glasses, sweet glasses. But I appreciate everybody being here, and forgive me as I look around and I've laid them down, probably back in my office somewhere. But I do want to appreciate everybody who's here today and tell you how much I thank you. And today we're going to be talking about, what is this love that we all want? What is this love that we all desire to have? And specifically, we're going to be looking at, what is love? I'm going to speak as I go in the back and try to find my glasses. So I just want to ask you to forgive me as I do this, because if I don't see, then I can't speak as I would like to. So anyway, as we get started this morning, again, I just want to take the time to thank everybody. And being here today, especially those of you that are visiting us, and again, I hope you've been able to find and see the love of God through those that are here on a regular basis. And some of you, it's really great to see back here again. And I'm hoping with God's help that we can answer that question, what is love, this morning. You know, I hear people talking about love all the time. You know, it's one of our most favorite subjects sometimes to talk about. And I think a lot of people think that love is sort of this feeling that we get in our stomach, you know. When we're in love, we have these butterflies, and everything is great. But then when the butterflies stop, it's sort of like the love stops, too. You know, we get to the point where we don't have that gushy-gushy feeling anymore. And when we don't get the goody-goody fishing, then it's sort of like, hey, maybe I'm not in love anymore. But I don't think that's the kind of love that God intended us to have. Fortunately for us, the Bible is full of all kinds of wisdom. It gives us an answer to the question that we're asking this morning, what is love? And in the scripture, it gives us an answer that's much more endearing. It's much more of a comprehensive answer than what the world's answer is to that very same question. The problem is, the words are very easy to read. They're very easy to understand. But for most of us, we're not willing to put the work into what it takes to really have that kind of love. Now when I say us, you got to remember, I'm included in us. So, as we get started today, you know, we hear these words by Dionne Warwick. We hear these words of what the world needs now is love, sweet love, and we sort of sing along with it, you know. And I have to tell you, I know you sang along with it because I was watching you. Okay, so we sing along with it, and according to the world, you know, these words, the world doesn't need any more mountains to climb. We don't need any more rivers to cross. What we need is love, sweet love, and not just for us, but for everybody. And we hear that, and we know it's true. It sort of hits us right in our hearts. No, we all know what the world needs is more love. Now, when we look at the scriptures, the subject that Jesus taught about more than anything else, his number one subject, if you take all the letters in red, if you have a red letter Bible, the subject he talked about more than anything else was the kingdom of heaven. He talked about the kingdom of God. And what he talked about, as he talked about, he was telling us its entry requirements. He was telling us its nature. He's telling us how close the kingdom of God. He's talking about the entry requirements, the nature, and the nearness. And most of us already know how near the kingdom of God is. Now, if you don't know how near the kingdom of God is, I'm just going to sort of refresh your memory right now. The kingdom of God is near. In fact, when Jesus came out of the desert, his first message was, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. Now, this is how near it is. Whether God comes back to us, or whether we go to him through death, the kingdom of God is nearer today than it was yesterday. The kingdom of God is close at hand for each one of us. Now, when he talks about the nature of heaven, and he talks about the entry requirements, he's very clear on what it is. In fact, he sort of sums everything up in just a couple of sentences. One day, he's walking along, and somebody stops him. He's got the crowd with him. And the guy says, what is the greatest commandment of all? In other words, what is the most important thing that I can do to get into the kingdom of God? Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but I'm sort of sure this is what they're thinking. They're probably thinking the same thing as I am. They're thinking, all right, I'll pray again. Jesus is about to tell me what I have to do, what the minimum requirement is going to be for me to get into heaven. Because we all want to go to heaven, right? But we want to know how much we can get away with and yet still get in, right? So the crowd is thinking, all right, now we're going to know what the minimum requirement is. What's the most important thing I can do to get into heaven? And Jesus sort of surprises them with the answer. He doesn't give them a list of rules. He doesn't tell them exactly what they think they're going to hear. Look at Jesus saying, and I'm paraphrasing, I'm rephrasing it, what he said, but it's the same thing. He says, all you need to do is give the world what it needs most. All you need is love, sweet love. He says, love God, and you love mankind. There are no greater commandments than these. And he even goes on to say, of all the Ten Commandments, if you'll just love God, and you'll love others, if you just have love, sweet love, every single one of the Ten Commandments will be fulfilled. Not only does he say that, everything the prophets have ever said, everything at that time, what we call our Old Testament, was their whole book of Scripture, everything in God's Word will be fulfilled if you just love God and love others. Just love, sweet love. Now, the Apostle Paul, who wrote about half the books of the New Testament, somebody we've talked a lot about in the past year, he writes in a letter. He's writing to the Christians in Rome. And in that letter, in that book of Romans, chapter 13, verse 9, not to be confused with the chapter we'll be talking about this morning, but God's Word is full of love. He says love is the fulfillment of the law. Again, he's sort of repeating what Jesus says. If you just have love, sweet love, everything else sort of falls into place. Every requirement that God has ever given you is satisfied in love. Jesus sort of adds to that in the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verse 35, where he says, the world will know that you're my disciples. He doesn't say the world will be known that you're Christians. The world would know as you're my disciples if you just love one another. It's the way you love is how people will know whether you're following me or not following me. Now, there's all kinds of stories that you hear. In fact, there was a story about a man named Russell Placence, and I think I'm pronouncing his name right. Russell's about 75 years old. He read an article in a local newspaper. And in this article, it told about a family that was having very, very difficult financial times. They lost everything that they had, and they were sort of reaching out to the community to help them out. They were living in a motel. Russell's 75. He gets it upon his heart to help this family. So he goes and buys food. He buys groceries. He buys all kinds of toys for the kids. He buys some clothes. And he gets in his car, and he drives over and gives everything to the family that's in need who's living in the motel. Now, that's a great story if it just ended there, but it didn't end there. And here's one of the problems we have in the world as to why it's so difficult to love. Russell's unconditional love towards his family, he didn't even know. He went back 2 days later, and what happened was the dad pulled a knife on him, one that he just held, took his watch, stole his car, and drove away. See, if every time we offered love, it was returned, we'd have no problem giving more love. If every time we love somebody, they gave it back to us, we'd have no problem giving love even to the meanest person we could find. I think the reason Jesus in his word, God in the Old Testament in his word, Paul in his writings, through what we believe the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, speaks so much and commands us to love is because you don't have to command somebody to do something that comes after you. Sometimes it's difficult to love. Jesus even makes a statement one time that you know, it's easy to love those that love you. Even the pagans do that. What's really hard and what I'm telling you to do is love those that have hurt you. Love your enemy like you love the person that's treating you the best. Love's not always returned. In fact, I think if we're honest with ourselves, most of the time, love's not returned. And sometimes when it is returned, we try to redirect it. We try to redefine it so it'll fit into our own lives, so it'll fit into what we want, so it'll fit into our own best interest. And then we have to take into the fact that love means different things to different people, doesn't it? I mean, depending on talking, love can have a lot of different meanings. Even in our everyday conversation, we use love in so many different ways. I mean, some people say, you know, I just love being out in nature. I just love to go fishing. I just love my new computer. I just love sports. I love my wife and I love my kids. I love a good steak. And I'm telling you, I love a good steak. So when we think about it, the way we use love sometimes is different depending on who's saying it, depending on the context that we're talking to, and it becomes obvious as you talk to different people, love really means different things to different people. So we can use the word love in a lot of different ways. Now the good news is, you know, it ain't gospel, that's good news. The good news is, God in his word, in all its wisdom, begins to tell us what the real kind of love that God wants us to have. The love of God, God's love, isn't like the world's love. Most of us, we get love and we expect something back in return. That God in a body, Jesus Christ, when he came to earth, came to give you every single thing we needed, not because we deserve it, because you know we don't, not because we have it all together, because you know we don't have it all together, not because we're like Jesus, because you know we're not. In fact, those of you who know me, I'm far from it. But Jesus came expecting nothing in return. And when you realize, when you can grasp that, when you realize the magnitude of all of that, if you could grasp that, we begin to reevaluate all our other relationships. The value of a relationship is not what you can get from the person, but what you can give to the person. It's not what you can get, but what you can give. Now, for those of you that may be familiar with scriptures and haven't figured it out yet, we're going to be looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's what we call the love chapter in the Bible. But to sort of put all this into context, I'm going to read the last part of chapter 12. I'm going to read verse 31. And in that verse, the Apostle Paul is writing to the Christians in Corinthians, or in Corinth. So you've got to remember, this letter was written to Christians. So that letter was written to those of us who have put our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ. He's writing to Corinthians. That's where we get the name of the book. And Paul starts his writing on love. He's just finished up his writings on spiritual gifts, and now he's transforming into love. So he starts his word out like this: "But now let me show you a way of life that is best of all." And there's some translations, the New King James Version translates like this, and I love the way the New King James Version, he goes, "You should earnestly desire the best gifts." He's been talking about spiritual gifts, and he says, you should desire those things. "But now, I show you a more excellent way." See, Paul's been saying throughout his letter, I've been showing some good ways to live. I've been telling you some things to do, and you should do those things. He goes, "But now I'm getting ready to show you the best way. I'm getting ready to show you the more excellent way, the way to live life and live it more abundantly." And now what you may not know is that Paul is writing to these Christians who are being torn apart. He's writing to a church, specifically in the city of Corinth, and they are being torn apart by anger, by conflict, by sin. And Paul's writing to a people who already know. Yet the first century Christians were so subject to terror and pain and persecution and all these other things. So they knew the importance of personal commitment. They knew the importance of sacrifice. The Corinthians, they knew the importance of faith. They knew the importance of knowledge and spiritual gifts and strong leaders and inspiring messages. The problem was, the people of the city, the people that were in this church in Corinth, were like many of the churches today. In the process of looking at their own interests, their own church, that they lost sight of what the goal was. They lost sight of their faith. They forgot that you can study God's Word, you can study the Scriptures, you can study the Bible, and you can pursue all the gifts of the Holy Spirit and miss the heart and mind of God. In your desire to be fulfilled, they forgot what they needed most. And what they needed most was one sweet love. In their desire, they forgot the most important factor, and that was love. So if you want to follow along with me in your Bibles, you're welcome and free to do so. The words will be up here on the screen. If you don't have a Bible with you, or you like the translation, I'll be speaking from the New Living Translation today. The Bibles are right by the front door. We encourage you to take them. They're there. They're free. They're our gift to you, because we want you to have the transforming Word of God in your hands, and if you know somebody needs a Bible, grab one and take it to them. So I'm going to start out this morning. Paul says, this is the way you have the more excellent way. This is the way you live and have the best life of all. If I could speak all the languages of the earth and all the languages of the angels, but I didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but I didn't love others, I would be nothing. If I gave everything I have to the poor and even sacrificed my body, I could boast about it, If I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable. It keeps no records of the wrongs of others. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices when the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Love never loses faith. Is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless, but love will last forever. Now our knowledge is partial and incomplete, and even the gift of prophecy reveals only in part of the whole picture. But when the time of perfection comes, these partial things will become useless. When I was a child, I spoke and I thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror. But then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All I know now is partial and incomplete. But then I will know everything completely, just as now God knows me. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. The Word of God for the people of God. Now, almost all commentators, those who study the Scriptures, those who study theology, the study of God, will take 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and then break it down into three parts. The first part, what we're talking about this morning, is verses 1 through 3, and that is, what is love? Then verse 4 through the first part of verse 8, what are the signs of love, or what is the manifestation of love? What does love look like? And then in the last part of verse 8 through the end of verse 13, how can I have that kind of love in my life? How can I have love in my life? So I'm telling you, you don't want to miss the next couple of weeks. We've got some great teachings, not from me, hopefully from God and other people that I've studied who are a lot smarter than me on the subject of love. Because we all need love, sweet love. It's what the world needs most. Now this chapter, what we call the love chapter, is actually one of the best known sections of Scripture in the entire Bible. It's spoken of a lot in Bible school, spoken a lot in Sunday school. It's quoted at weddings all the time. And when it comes to Sunday morning messages, there are some challenges when you're speaking about Scriptures that are well known. There's some advantages and there's some disadvantages to speaking on well-known verses. The advantage is we all have a common ground. People know right away the facts and the words of the chapter. You don't have to spend a whole lot of time setting up the facts. Even if you haven't spent a lot of time in church or you haven't read your Bibles a whole lot, you've probably heard most of the words in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So we can get right down to business. We can get right to the message. We can get right to the application. But there's also a disadvantage with dealing with well-known Scriptures. And part of that is people just sort of tune me out and they go to sleep. They're like, I've already heard this. I've already heard messages on 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I've heard it. Love, 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 love. Oh, so what? We all need to love each other. I already know that. I mean, I don't actually do it, but I know that. So when we come to a familiar passage of Scripture, we have to rely on God's Holy Spirit to give us new truth and also to help us remember old truth. And whether it's old or whether it's new, it's true, so therefore it's important. Whether it's old or whether it's new, we have to ask God to open our hearts to His message. Now, I want you to try to use your imagination this morning. Try to think about this. And it's not in today's world with what's on TV. It's not going to be that hard to imagine. But imagine the most corrupt city that you can think of. The most heartless city that you can think of in the entire world. A city that gives love a bad name. Where relationships by intention or self-centered, where lives are routinely destroyed. This was the city of Corinth. Even by today's standard, Corinth, what was in a sort of in a section all by itself, this was the home where the first Christians would read the inspired words of this letter, the Apostle Paul, as written. I mean, it sort of seemed, when I think about that initially, it sort of seemed strange to me that the first people to read this beautiful letter, this inspired letter on love, would be the people that are associated with a city that had no real love in it, which was known at the time in history as to be very sexual, very lustful, everything but real love. But if you think about it, once you start studying it and thinking about that, you can see that there was probably no other city on earth at that time that needed to hear this message more. There was ever a group of people who needed to hear the teaching of real love as God had designed it, it was the church in Corinth. Even by today's standard, the church in Corinth had a lot to overcome. The culture had absolutely no morals. They were a decadent society. Most people in this city, they worshipped the god Aphrodite. And Aphrodite was the Greek god of love. Aphrodite's temple alone employed over 1,000 prostitute priestesses. So you got the church in Corinth over here, and right across the street you got Aphrodite's temple, and the Christians are looking at what's going on over there and going, you want me to do what? That looks like a whole lot more fun over there. So what has happened is the culture is starting to influence the church. Now the other problem is, there was a lot of money in Corinth. Corinth was one of the richest cities around. So wealth became another challenge. Corinth connected northern and southern Greece, and that provided a great amount of commercial prosperity, which led to more economy. You know, to sort of think about how things are here in the United States, think of Las Vegas, you know. It's no wonder they call it Sin City. Materialism, with a sexually oriented culture where everything is based on personal pleasure, and it just begins to produce a climate of moral failings, of immorality. Corinth was so well known for its corruption that if you were involved in some kind of self-indulgence, some kind of decency, if you were involved in alcoholism, drug abuse, pornography, something like that, and you got caught, people would say, you're acting just like a Corinthian. This is an environment. This is the environment that Apostle Paul writes God's greatest letter of love to. Same things happen in Corinth. This happened in a lot of churches today. Some churches and even some denominations are allowing sexual immorality to influence their doctrine, personal pleasure, and some are even beginning to celebrate. Now, you know, I wonder, if you take a white glove and you throw it in a mud puddle, the mud puddle doesn't become white. The glove starts to take on the characteristics of the mud puddle. Same things begin to happen in the church of Corinth. Instead of Corinth beginning to change the culture in Corinth, the church in Corinth is beginning to take on the culture and the characteristics of the Corinthian city of Corinth. It's the same thing that's happening in some of our churches today. And if we're not careful, if we're not careful, if we don't watch our teachings, the same thing can happen here. Now, if you ever take the time to read this letter, you'll see that Paul has already dealt with a lot of issues in 1 Corinthians. Chapter 1 through 3, Paul deals with the division of the family. In chapter 4, he deals with pride and spiritual arrogance. In chapter 5, he talks about sexual promiscuity. In chapter 6, lawsuits between believers. Chapter 7, he talks about troubled marriages. In chapter 8 through 10, he talks about spiritual liberty. Chapter 11, he talks about the abuse of the Lord's table. Chapter 12, the misuse of spiritual gifts. On top of everything else, the Corinthians, much like some Christians today, didn't even see a need for Paul's teaching. They're involved in all these things that go against God's word, and they don't see a need to change. They think everything's okay. Let me tell you something, folks. If you're going against God's word, everything is not okay. So what's the solution? Well, Paul begins to describe the spiritual gift, speaking in eloquent speech, however you interpret that, gifts like healing and gifts like working miracles and gifts like prophesizing. And what Paul is saying in these first three verses that we're going to look at this morning is it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what gifts God has given you. If you don't have love, every other gift is absolutely useless to you. If you don't have love, you're just making a whole bunch of noise. I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, but didn't love others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. This is important. This is important. I want you to hear that. To follow Jesus truly, takes more than just a pursuit of knowledge of what's in His Word. It takes more than a pursuit of wisdom or even the pursuit of some sort of supernatural power or some gift of Him. To live the way that God wants you to live the best life of all, to live the more excellent way, you have to love others. So the first thing, I want to point out this point, first thing I want you to, love is not a gift from God. That's going to sound strange, but I'm going to start out by saying, love is not a gift from God. Speaking with the tongues of angels, gift of God. Speaking with the prophecy, gift of God. Understanding mystery, gift of God. Having knowledge, gift of God. But according to another letter which Paul wrote to the Christians in Galatia, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23, love is a fruit. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, self-control, gentleness. There is no law against these things. Now, if you notice, the word fruit is singular. It's not plural. There's only one fruit, and that's love. Everything else, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, all those are parts of love. If you have love, if you, God has given you the fruit of love, real love, then you're going to have joy. You're going to have peace. If you love, you'll have kindness. If you love, you'll have goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. All these are the manifestation of love. If I had the gift of prophecy, and I understood all of God's secret plans, possessed all knowledge, if I had such faith that I could move mountains and didn't love others, I would be nothing. Paul wants the Corinthians to know. God wants you to know. God wants me to know. That's why He put it in His Word, so we can know all the eloquent arguments, all the speeches, all the great sermons, all the right doctrine, all the expressions of faith, all the sacrificial giving would actually, and we've seen it, drive others away from God if we don't have love. Paul's showing us what can happen when we attempt to do good things without love. Eloquent speaking, the highest worship, is nothing but a loud noise. Spiritual insight, the greatest teaching, the most faith, amounts to nothing. Even the greatest surrender will have no personal profit without love. See, we see these programs all the time on TV about giving. Give to the poor, give to the victim of the earthquake, give to the victim of the tsunami, give them to the victims of the tornado, whatever the natural event is at the time, whatever the cause is at the moment. But have you ever thought about giving absolutely every single thing that you have? I mean, everything. Not a little bit. You sell your house, you sell your car. You give every dollar that comes in from your paycheck. You give them everything you own. This is the illustration that Paul's giving. He said, I'm not talking about giving 50% of what you have. I'm not talking about giving 80% or even 99%. I'm talking about you giving 100% of all your material things to the poor, and then you give them your life as well. I gave everything I had to the poor and even sacrificed my body. I could boast about it, but if I didn't love others, I would gain nothing. Even if I give everything away and I'm martyred in the name of Jesus Christ, if I don't have love, I might be able to brag about what I've done, but it profits me nothing. I haven't gained anything in God's eyes. See, here was something sort of surprising when I started to look at it. It says, you can have a gift from God without having God himself. You know, I'm going to tell you, one of the most sobering illustrations, this is one of the scariest verses in the Bible to me, and honestly, if you would pay attention to it, I think it would be a scary verse to you as well. It's found in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 7. It says, not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of my Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name, and we cast out demons in your name, and we performed many miracles in your name. Jesus says, I will reply to them, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's law. That's a scary verse, because I got to tell you something. It's not that these people weren't doing anything. They were doing a lot. I mean, as far as I know, I've never prophesied. I'm not aware of any time that I've cast out a devil. I've never performed any miracles. I think the question is really Jesus saying, do you know me? Or do you just know about me? Do you know me or just do you know about me? And he seems to make a distinction between those who know him and those who just know about him. See, the insight of the Corinthians needs to be our insight as well. It's possible for us to get a lot of information, to have a lot of information about the Bible, and not share its heart. In one of the speakers, Glaze speaker classes, one of the classes I took before I became a pastor, I was talking to an ordained minister, and we were talking about the scriptures. And I said, I think one of the reasons people have so much trouble believing in Jesus is they never read the Bible. And he said, I disagree with you. He goes, I was taught in seminary by guys who could quote the entire Bible, yet still didn't believe in God. Didn't believe Jesus was who he said he was. See, the thing is, we can quote this back and forth. We can have all the knowledge in the world, and if you miss its heart, you miss God. It's possible for us to look around and see the wrongs of others and miss the fact without love, we're more wrong than they are. Here's the good news. This isn't meant to condemn us. It's meant to teach us. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 isn't to knock us down, but to lift us up. It's for those of us who may have lost our way in trying to get biblical knowledge. It's for those of us who may let the failures of our relationships and let our attitudes ruin our Christian reputation. It's to help remind us that we can't let our own interest hurt the credibility of the Lord. You know, I'm sure you all heard this before. People won't care about how much we know until they see how much we care. Other people aren't going to believe what we say. They're not going to believe it unless they can see we're as much concerned about them as we are concerned about ourselves. Without the love of Jesus, evangelism just becomes judgmental. Without the love of Jesus, personal commitment just becomes self-righteousness. Without the love of Jesus, worship becomes routine. Without the love of Jesus, service becomes an obligation. See, God isn't merely calling us to higher ground in this chapter. He's offering the changes from the inside out. He's not just offering a higher standard of living, a more excellent way. He's offering to lift us up above our own natural way to do what we can't do on our own. The challenge is, do we surrender and submit to the Lord and let His truth come into us so that we can produce the real love that's described in 1 Corinthians chapter 13? What is love? Here's the most basic biblical answer. Love is the life of God. That sounds easy. You know, we have this idea that love is this kind of thing where we just sort of get starry-eyed. Now, some of you aren't old enough, but some of you may be old enough like me to remember Dean Martin's song, "That's the Lord." When the moon hits your eyes like a big pizza pie, that's the Lord. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore. See, that's the world's view of love. But it's not God's view of love. We get the idea that love is an emotion. Love is a verb. It's an action. We get the idea that love is just something that makes us feel good. So what is this thing? What is this thing called love that makes everything else worthless? What is this thing which is the nature and the requirement to even enter into the kingdom of God? What is this thing which is the fulfillment of the law and the fulfillment of everything the prophets have ever said? What is love? Well, I'm going to give you a couple references from the scriptures, and then I'm going to give you an illustration, and I'm hoping that I don't confuse you with the illustration. Because those of you that know me, you know, sometimes I'm confused, and my confusion just passes on to you. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8 says, "But anyone who does not love God does not know God, for God is love." And then it goes on in chapter 16, it says, "We know how much God loves us. God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them." Love is simply the expression of the life of God. So here's the illustration, and again, I pray I don't confuse you. What do dogs give life to? Oh. What do horses give life to? Horses. That's the fruit of their union. Horses produce horses. Cats produce cat. The fruit of my union with my wife Janet is Taylor and Kayla. Life gives life to like others. See, Paul's told us in Galatians the fruit of the Spirit, which is God, is love. So sometimes we look at love and we think it's something that we can do on our own. That's why there's so much broken marriage, so many broken relationships, so many broken families. Because we think we can do all this on our own. And if people don't give back to us, we're not give back to them. But then you look at verses in the scriptures like love your neighbor as yourself. Why the neighbor next to me? That's me on a goal. Forgive one another as Christ has forgiven you. That guy stabbed me in the back. How am I supposed to? He took my job and kicked my family out to the curb. How am I supposed to love him? And everything gives thanks? You mean everything? Joy, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. I mean, any of you ever tried to do that? Rejoice in everything? Turn the other cheek when you've been hurt? Blessed are they who are persecuted? Yeah, right. Now what? Here's the principle. Just like dogs give life to dogs, and horses give life to horses, life must give life to like kind. And only God can produce the life of God. And the life of God is love. See, this chapter is about how God sees love And the love of God is the love that only He can produce. Yet we think the Christian life, and so many people think the Christian life, and they teach it, is just simply about obeying God. Man trying to produce things that only God can produce. Trying to live up to some kind of impossible standard that man could never live up to. Because if we could live up to it, we wouldn't have needed Jesus to come and do it for us. Romans 5:5 says, the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. It is God, the Holy Spirit, who pours this love into our hearts so it comes out of us. And that's the only way we can get it. That's why Paul began this chapter the way he did. He said, if you had the tongues of angels, if you had all knowledge, if you had all faith, even if you gave your life as a sacrifice, but you did not have the life of God, if you don't have love, which only comes from God Himself, you have nothing. I'm going to try and pull all this together. God gives us these gifts, as Paul describes in chapter 12, because we're weak. God gives us gifts because we have needs and we have these deficiencies. They're just props. They're training wheels. They're crutches and wheelchairs and stretchers. God gives me the gift of faith until my character is changed by the life of God. When the Holy Spirit changes me by the life of God and produces that love in me, He gives me His fruit. I don't need the gift of faith anymore because love believeth all things. Faith is included in the change. I don't need the gifts of help anymore. I don't need the gift of service. I don't need the gift of service because when I'm conformed into Christ, you want to help one another. It's included in the change. As I take in the character of God, as I knew Jesus, as His life is being produced in me, as I become rooted in Him, gentleness and kindness and all these other things become part of the change. The more I become like God, and God is love, the more these other things come along and are produced in my life through that change. As I get established in the truth, I'll have the life, I'll have the fruit of God, which is love. When I'm conformed to Christ, you'll have the love you need. Love is the life of God, and until we have that love according to God's word, according to Paul, we don't have a thing. See, we tend in our humans, and I've been guilty of this, I'm still guilty of this time, we measure other Christians by how great their gifts are. If they're a great teacher, if they're this or they're that. But God has a more excellent way. God measures not on the gifts we have, but on what we do and how we love. The more excellent way, the life that's best of all, is the life of God produced in the Christian. The life that's the best life of all, that is the more excellent way. Without the life of God, without the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, whatever else you have is meaningless. The Christian life is the life of Jesus Christ, and without His life, you have nothing. And if you begin to see this in action in your life, and if you begin to see it, you will be changed, I promise you. If you have Christ living in you, if you allow God to conform you to His Son, you can have love, sweet love. Because without love, sweet love, you have, according to God's word, nothing. Now, does that mean that we'll be perfect in our love in every way? Of course not. I had a moment this morning where I was busy and somebody said something to me, and I responded in not a lovely manner. See, there's a difference, and I speak of this often, there's a difference between having an occasion of sin and a walk towards the cross, and a walk that's in the direction of sin with an occasion from the cross. When you begin to feel the love of God in your life, when God begins to transform your life with His love, and you begin to give that to others, folks, I'm just telling you, it's life-changing. It is life-changing. the desires of this world grow strangely dim. I want you to see this. Because just in a few minutes, we're going to have the opportunity to come to the Lord's table. And our Lord invites all to his table who truly repented of their sin and seek to live in love with others. But Romans 5:8 makes this claim. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Think about how much God must have loved us to do that. He didn't wait for us to get cleaned up. He died for us while we were still a mess. When you begin to see God's love in action, it changes everything. And I ask you to start to prepare your hearts for communion. Communion is just a simple way that God has given us to remember what he's done for us on the cross. You know why he gave us a way to remember? Because he knew we'd forget. The Lord's table proves Jesus' great love for us. So as we prepare to take communion, I want you to think about these questions. Who gave his life for you? The Bible says Jesus did. Who created this world for you to live in? The Bible says Jesus did. Who knows everything you've ever done, you've ever said, or ever thought? The Bible says Jesus does. Who knows about all your sins? The Bible says that Jesus does. I want you to think about this, knowing every evil thing you've ever done, every terrible thought you've ever said, everything that's ever come into your mind that goes against him, who wants to be next to you in heaven? The Bible says Jesus does. Who wants to keep you from going to hell? The Bible says Jesus does. Who loves you so much that he left his home in heaven just for you? The Bible says Jesus did. Who loved you so much that he shed his own blood and died for you? Jesus did. Who loved you so much that he rose from the dead and went back to heaven to build you a mansion with many rooms to live in? Jesus did. Who wants you to come to him and tell him how sorry you are for the things you've done and that you'll try and turn away from them with his help? Jesus does. Who wants to live in your heart if you'll just ask him? Jesus does. Who loves you so much that he wants to share his riches and his power and his glory with you? Jesus does. Who loves you so much that he'll put angels at your side to protect you? Jesus does. Who loves you so much that he wants to be right at your side throughout all eternity? Jesus does. Now that's a story of love. Who among us could ever love like that? Only God Almighty. And that's who Jesus is. So the only way to know the love that God desires for us to experience, to live the life, that's the best life of all, to live the life, the more excellent way, is to let Jesus into your heart and to let us receive his fruit, which is life. I'm going to ask Rob if he'll come up and help me, and we'll start in the back row. What we'll do is you'll accept the bread. Rob will say, this is the bread representing the body of Christ given for you. And you'll drip the bread into the juice, which is the blood of Christ, which was spilled for you. And then if you'd like to come to the altar and just spend time with your Heavenly Father, you'd like to come and ask him into your heart, if you'd like to come and just say thank you for being in my life and in my heart, please feel free to do so. And don't be rushed. This is not a sacrament. This is not something to rush, but to cherish. As we close this morning, I want to remind you that these altars are still open. If you want to come up and give your heart to Jesus Christ, I just want you to know He's waiting for you. You can experience the love of Jesus right now, right here. Just come forward. Jesus died for you publicly. I believe a public confession of Christ as your Lord and Savior just thrills His heart. As we talked about last week, there will be joy in the presence of angels. But you know, you might be like me. Maybe you were just trying to do all this on your own. And that was me. I was trying to be this obedient soldier. I was trying to work as hard as I could for God. And the more I did, the more wearisome I became. I had to realize one day that I couldn't do it in my own power. I love God. My salvation was secure. I believe that. But I was trying to do it in my own power and not in His power. I occasionally still get that way, and people can tell because I become short-tempered and irritable and things like that. But when you just turn it over to Jesus and you surrender, you let Him handle it, His life, His fruit, His love, all comes alive, and He's just waiting for that. But you know, these altars are also an altar of thanks. If you've experienced the love of Jesus already, you can always come up here and just give thanks to your Heavenly Father. Just ask yourself this morning before you leave, is Christ living in me? Can others see Christ in me by the way I love them? And if the answer is no, the altars are open. But if the answer is yes, why not come up and give a thanks? Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your love. A love that goes so deep that while we were yet sinners, you were willing to send your Son to die for us. Father, in my humanness, I'm stubborn and I'm arrogant and I'm prideful. And when somebody hurts me, I wait for them to come to me to ask forgiveness. And yet, Lord, we've hurt you over and over and over again. And even before we knew who you were, you died for us. Father, we thank you for that. Father, we praise you for that. And Father, as we go forth today, may the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be among us and within us wherever we find ourselves this week. Amen.